Good morning. This is David Levenstein. We are back to business. If you are a business owner, a professional, please contact me at my show at jvcbroadcasting.com. That's my show at jvcbroadcasting.com. My guest is Neil Himmelstein. He is the host of The Code to Financial Success, which can be heard every Friday at 3 p.m. In addition, you can reach out to Neil and speak with him personally by visiting his website, mainstreetplanninggroup.com. That's mainstreetplanninggroup.com. Neil, tell everybody what it is that you do for a living.
Ah, yes. Well, I'm an independent wholesaler
right.
of 30 different insurance companies, specializing in life insurance, annuities, disability, and long-term care, and providing solutions for people in the insurance world.
So one of those solutions that I want to discuss is a lifetime of income. And a lifetime of income really wraps itself around what many pensions and have their money invested in, which is annuities.
Right.
Which you don't have to necessarily work or be a member of a large union or work for a big company to have an annuity for yourself. If you don't, and you'd like to create a lifetime of income, a pension for yourself.
Right.
How would one go about that? What's the process?
Well, you know, if you're self-employed, certainly we can devise a pension for yourself, or even if you're not self-employed, if you work for a company. So a pension in its very nature is a group annuity. So people don't realize that, I got a pension. You have a group annuity.
Right.
And then you're offered different types of income strategies when you retire.
Yeah, when people are receiving their pension, aren't you at least a little curious how they can afford to pay you for the rest of your life?
Right.
And the answer to that question is an annuity. What is an annuity?
So an annuity is something offered by insurance companies, which can calculate, you know, income based on amount of money you put in that you can have for the rest of your life. And the nice thing is you can never run out of money with an annuity. It's all figured out actuarially. And
so you can never outlive your money.
You can't outlive your money. So you can create your own pension by buying an annuity and continuing to put money in, and it will grow tax deferred like a regular pension, but you will pay taxes on the gain when you retire, or you can create your own pension with life insurance where you can actually bring the money, grow tax deferred, but you're using after-tax money, like a Roth IRA, but all the money comes out to you tax-free. So you could create a tax-free income stream for the rest of your life.
Can that be monies that are paid in one lump sum if people haven't started this? Let's say they say, well, you know, I'm 65 years old. I should have started this when I'm 45.
Correct.
Not necessarily the case, right? You can roll money into it, right?
Absolutely.
Explain that.
So you can either roll it into an annuity at any time.
What type of money? Qualified money?
Qualified or non-qualified.
Okay. Qualified meaning 401k or IRA or things like that.
Right.
Or non-qualified, which is any other money you might have in any kind of investment account or bank account.
And the whole thing about qualified is has to do with the IRS and taxes.
Okay.
So if it's qualified money, you've probably already taken tax deductions for it.
Right.
So the government says, well, when you take that money out, you're going to be taxed.
As ordinary income.
As ordinary income. Right. Now, even though a Roth IRA or a Roth 401k is considered qualified money, but you've used after-tax money, and you could take it out tax-free. However, even in a Roth IRA or Roth 401k, there are requirements of when you can touch your money. And typically, you have to be 59 and a half unless you create a payment stream or you know, you have to start taking it later. So there's some qualification. With life insurance, there is none.
Right.
And if you leave the money in the life insurance policy and you don't take money out, it goes to your heirs tax-free very efficiently, and it's credit shelter-proof.
But can you pay for life insurance with qualified money?
No, you can't. You have to use non-qualified money.
Non-qualified money. Okay. So that being said, so let's say you have...
If you're part of a company, or you have your own company, and you've set up a pension for your company, you can carve out some of that money towards life insurance policy and have it deductible. It's the only way.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
So you can write up a plan. If you're starting a 401k for your company, you can write up a plan in the plan document that will will allocate certain monies to life insurance
as part of a defined benefit plan.
Right. So how do people turn a life insurance policy into income?
It's very simple. The money grows tax deferred.
Mm-hmm.
You can take it out tax free at any time.
Right.
Whether you're 30, 40, 50, 60, 80, it doesn't make any difference.
So when you say the money grows tax deferred, that means the premiums.
That means whatever money you put in there.
Mm-hmm. But some of the money has to go to pay for the insurance.
Some of it pays for the insurance.
Right.
And the rest earns interest either by dividends in a whole life policy, mm-hmm, or using an indexing strategy where it's a fixed interest through that, or a fixed interest rate that fluctuates with rates,
right?
Like in universal life policies, or even in variable accounts that are mutual fund type accounts that could grow.
So when you put your premium payment in, whether it's a single premium or monthly premium, a portion of that monies will go to pay for the life insurance component.
Correct.
Right? And then another portion of that money will go towards, I guess, a cash value that can be...
Correct.
That can be set up to give you a stream of income forever?
Correct. So the strategy that people don't understand is they want this cash value, and they want that cash value.
Right.
The strategy is to make that life insurance cost as low as you possibly can.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not to buy the most amount of life insurance. It's to utilize that life insurance cover to maximize your cash.
But if you can
do both.
What is it called when people put more an endowment?
A
modified endowment. That means, let's say you have an X amount of insurance and you're overfunding your policy.
Right.
Right? And you're overfunding your policy that will more than pay for the cost of insurance, right? You're allowed
you
to
can,
a certain...
You can do that to a certain extent.
To a certain extent.
But if so you go what past, happened yeah. is years ago,
yeah,
life insurance had such wonderful qualities to it,
right,
that the ultra rich were saying, okay, I had $1 million, I'm going to throw it into a life insurance policy. I don't care about the debt. Give me $1.2 million. I don't really want to pay for the life insurance. I just want to use this as a cover.
Mm-hmm.
So they put in this thing called a modified endowment contract that said you need to have a corridor of insurance in there if you're buying life insurance, or it's considered a MEC or a modified endowment contract.
And what does that mean to you?
Not necessarily bad to have a MEC. People say, oh, it's a MEC. It's horrible. Oh, my God. We want to avoid a MEC.
MEC is a modified endowment
contract is what it's called.
Okay.
So it still will grow just like an annuity, a MEC will.
Mm-hmm.
So you still have tax deferral.
Right.
But it'll get taxed like an annuity if you take the income out of a MEC. Not necessarily a bad thing.
But not all the income, because the money that's going in
only
there.
Only the growth.
Only the capital appreciation, right.
Right. The death benefit is still tax-free in a MEC. It's not tax-free in an annuity.
So when the money comes out, if you overfund your insurance policy, creating a modified endowment contract, right?
Right.
And you take the money out, the only thing that's taxable is not the principal that you put in to fund it, right?
Right.
Is going to be any additional growth that it has seen.
Correct.
So,
and if you don't touch your money,
mm-hmm,
it's tax-free to your heirs.
Oh, I see.
It's not necessarily a bad thing. Now, an annuity,
mm-hmm,
is a great accumulation vehicle.
Right.
Not the best vehicle at death.
Mm-hmm.
Because it is, that growth will be taxable.
Right.
When you take the money out.
Okay.
Or at death, it could be taxable.
But
and could be part of your estate, an annuity.
Explain to me the how it works with a modified endowment, though. So if someone has $300,000, right, and they're 65 years old, and they go, I want to put this money in a life insurance policy.
Right.
And I want to use a greater portion of that to fund my income versus the life insurance, right?
Correct. We do that.
Okay. So that being said, so when you take your income out, what portion of your income comes from your initial deposit, which is not taxable, and then what portion of the income comes from the growth? How does that work?
Well, they take out the interest first, and you have to pay whatever interest is grown. So you have to pay the interest first, and then the principal is tax-free. So,
Gotcha. So can it be funded with a single premium?
Yes, it can.
And the amount of life insurance you get will be dependent upon how you're underwritten, I imagine, right?
Yeah, and quite truthfully, sometimes we do this to not have a lot of life insurance, but just to have an extra cash vehicle,
mm-hmm,
that I want to leave behind. Now, let's talk about this for practical purposes. Let's say I had an extra $100,000 laying around.
Right.
Okay. I could buy an annuity,
mm-hmm,
and use it for income. Maybe I'm not going to use it. But, you know, I might want to use it later.
Right.
So maybe I might want to buy a mech. And you know what? When if I leave it in that life insurance contract and I don't touch it, it's just rainy day money. Mm-hmm. Well, maybe I buy $150,000 or $200,000 of life insurance.
Right.
That goes tax-free to my heirs.
Right.
Where that $100,000 sitting in my account is not necessarily tax-free to my heirs.
Interesting. I want to talk about that more. So this is, we're talking about right now a single premium dumping, right?
Right.
Right. Okay, my name is David Levenstein. I'm here with Neil Himmelstein. He is the host of The Code to Financial Success, which you can hear every Friday at 3 p.m. We are back to business. If you are a business owner, please contact me at my show at jvcbroadcasting.com. I would love to hear what you have to say. I know all of Long Island will as well, and we'll be back more with Neil Himmelstein. We are back to business. My name is David Levenstein. My guest is Neil Himmelstein. He's the host of The Code to Financial Success, which can be heard every Friday at 3 p.m. Please, to learn more about Neil and to make an appointment with him to talk about how he can help you create a pension for yourself, please visit MainStreetPlanningGroup.com. That's the MainStreetPlanningGroup.com. Have a conversation with him, a phone call, listen to his radio show, meet face-to-face, and let him educate you. And we're going to continue our conversation about how you can create a pension for yourself. So life insurance, by putting a large premium single deposit into a life insurance policy, buying the minimum amount of insurance, maximizing the income benefit that you can receive for yourself, you're going to create not only an income that is tax efficient, but an income that you can't outlive. Explain that part, that component.
Right. So essentially, as long as the life insurance stays in put,
right,
you can structure it so you can have money forever. And some companies even have riders that say, okay, we're going to guarantee an income stream forever, regardless of anything.
Right.
The key is not to let that life insurance policy lapse.
Can you have a spousal continuation, or it doesn't really matter, because when you die, your spouse gets the insurance?
It gets the death benefit.
The death benefit. So you'll have an income, and then something happens to you, pass away, your spouse will get the death benefit.
Tax-free.
So, okay, now you said the key is to not let the...
Unlike a pension.
So the key is not to let the life insurance expire. So what does that mean? So if you're doing a single premium, which is instead of paying a monthly premium to a life insurance policy, you're doing like just a single deposit, large deposit.
Right.
How do you take income out and not let the life insurance lapse?
Well, the key is you have to keep the face low and talk to your advisor and structure it correctly.
Right.
You don't want to take out too much at once. We have a lot of real estate investors mm-hmm. that use life insurance to, they'll put money in there, and then when they need a lump sum of money, they'll borrow it
right.
rather than take it. They'll borrow it. There's two ways you can get money out. You can borrow it, which is no tax when you borrow money from it.
Yeah, you don't put tax on loans.
And or you can take withdrawals to cost at no tax.
Right. When you borrow money from your life insurance policy,
it's not taxable.
But you have to pay it back.
You have to pay it back, or you know, structure a way so that there's always got to be money in that policy,
right, to fund
to
the
pay
insurance.
The policy charges. Even though you paid up front mm-hmm. for a policy, there's still policy charges going on,
right,
to maintain that death benefit. Mm-hmm. And that's where some people can get in trouble long term.
Right.
But in the short term, you have a lot of real estate investors, including John McCain, funded his campaign.
Right.
He was short like $80,000 or $800,000. He had all this money stashed away in life insurance policy, borrowed it, paid it back while the monies were coming in.
Really?
Yeah. There's a lot of people do that with buying real estate. Right. They'll use it as their own bank. Because here's what happens with real estate, especially investors. Okay, they see a property, whether it's commercial or residential, whatever it is, and they want to buy that property. So typically, they would get maybe a bridge loan.
Right.
A bridge loan, you need an application, you need to go through this, you need to go through that.
Right.
But if you have money sitting in life insurance policy, you can borrow it at a much lower rate,
right,
you know, or almost nothing,
mm-hmm.
buy that property, build it, sell it, pay it back.
Right.
And you see a lot of people doing that. And really savvy people use that as an additional tool.
And as long as there's enough money in there to pay the expenses of the insurance policy,
correct,
the premium, your insurance won't lapse, and the insurance policy
correct
will still be healthy.
Right.
Wow, that's pretty
what
interesting.
What a great thing. And the other thing is life insurance is credit shelter proof.
Right.
They can't go after it. Right. Not even credit shelter proof.
So if you're being sued or you file bankruptcy,
right,
your policies are protected.
Correct. And not only is that is protected, mm-hmm. But if you're applying, let's say, for your kid's college or something, and you have money in a life insurance policy, right, they say on the FAFSA application when mm-hmm. you're going to college, do not include any cash value in life insurance or annuities. They say it right there on the application.
When describing your assets, right.
Correct.
Interesting.
So it's a big deal. So that's, you know, you have a lot of people who are doing emergency college planning,
right,
who want to get loans and grants and whatever, but they have too many assets. And one of the ways they do it is they'll buy annuities or life insurance, and then they'll borrow the money through student loans. Mm-hmm. And then maybe they'll pay it back later when they feel like it or when it's more advantageous to them. Mm. So they'll do high cash value insurance policies and then, or annuities, and then pay it back later. And
if any of these strategies, I'm talking to the listeners now, you in the cars, if any of these strategies are ringing a little bell in your head saying, I'd like to learn more about that, how you can create an income for yourself, listen to Neil every Friday at 3 p.m. right here on LNN's Radio as he hosts the Code to Financial Success, and you will learn about not only how Neil can help you, but the tools that he uses to help you maintain integrity in your retirement as you get older for your, you know, for long-term care insurance, which we'll talk about in the last 5 minutes.
Right.
To have some integrity in your life as you get older, some dignity, you know, not to be a burden on your children, not to be a burden on your family by having long-term care insurance. His website is mainstreetplanninggroup.com, mainstreetplanninggroup.com. I read somewhere that there's an 80% greater chance of you being disabled and needing long-term care insurance than there is dying prematurely.
Yep.
And that being said, people do have life insurance for if they should die, you know, before they're supposed to. But long-term care insurance, I don't think people have enough of.
No. So the odds of someone needing long-term care today mm-hmm. is over 70%, which is 2 out of 3.
Mm-hmm.
More than 2 out of 3 people will need some assistance beyond what medical insurance is going to pay for or anything else. So
I will tell you that with my mother specifically, who lives in Florida right now, a lot of the private pay assisted living communities and the skilled nursing communities here on Long Island, they don't accept Medicaid. So they accept, you got to pay for it. And they all ask about their long-term care policy. My parents never had a long-term care policy.
Right.
Had my mother had a long-term care policy, she would be living in New York today, one of these nicer places.
Right. And, you know, the cost is ridiculous. $400-$500 a day? I mean, how many mm-hmm. days can you do that?
You can't.
And it's terrible. And the problem is that Medicaid is the number one provider,
mm-hmm.
which is the state and federal government.
For long-term care.
And they're bleeding.
Right.
They're bleeding cash. So they're trying to find any way to shore that up or limit benefits.
Are they bleeding cash because people are living a lot longer than
yes.
than they were supposed to? I mean, my mother is 87 years old.
Right.
And statistically, when Medicaid came out, people were living into their late 60s, maybe 70, you know? And
well, the whole system is skewed because of that.
Right.
And even 30 years ago, when they started having long-term care insurance and the conversations,
sure,
the average long-term care usage mm-hmm. was 2.5 years. Like the average time you'd spend in a nursing home was 2.5 years. That was the statistic.
Not anymore.
Now it's 8 years or I don't know what it is.
Right.
And if it's due to mental, Alzheimer's or dementia, which the probability that we get at some point, they just can't figure out how to keep our brains. They can keep our bodies alive forever. But the brains will deteriorate in some form or another at some point.
Yeah, my mother is physically healthy, but she has some dementia.
Okay.
And her brain is not.
And Alzheimer's can last 14 years.
So.
And people are getting that in their 50s and 60s.
So the inherent problem with Medicaid is that people are living longer than was designed when Medicaid was designed.
Correct.
So long-term care insurance is really the answer to that. Knowing that you want to live a long time, knowing that you're living a healthy lifestyle, long-term care insurance is a wonderful added benefit.
Sure. And it stops you from being a burden on your children.
Right.
And or your spouse. I mean, it's not just a financial burden to people. What an emotional burden.
It is.
And the caregivers.
Right.
Like, I know you, David. I don't know, in the last year, how many times you've flown down to Florida.
Every other month.
Every other month.
Yeah.
And that's costly. Now, you can afford it.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's a lot of money and a lot of aggravation. And, yeah, you love your mom.
But still, it's less money for me to fly down every other month than it is to bring it back to a community up here.
No, I get it.
Yeah. And if she had long-term care insurance, I wouldn't be in that position.
But look at the strain it is on you. And luckily, you're able to do that.
Yeah.
You know.
Sometimes it's tighter than others. Yeah. Okay. So let me remind you, I'm speaking with Neil Himmelstein. Listen to him every Friday on the Code to Financial Success, which can be heard at 3 p.m. For more information and to speak to Neil immediately about any of the things we were talking about today, please visit MainStreetPlanningGroup.com. That's MainStreetPlanningGroup.com. Make an appointment with Neil. Hey,